Greetings, this is Brother Eli with another episode of Bible Truth Revealed. Today's topic is the Revelation of Lucifer. The Revelation of Lucifer. Most Christians and Christianlites believe that Satan and Lucifer are the same being and that this being is the enemy of the Most High. Today, we will discover that Satan and Lucifer are two separate beings. We will also learn who the real enemy is. The word Lucifer is mentioned only once in the Bible, Isaiah chapter 14, verse 12. A parallel passage to Isaiah 14 is Ezekiel chapter 28. These scriptures address a powerful being called the King of Babylon and the Prince of Tyre. When comparing both passages, it soon becomes clear that the King of Babylon and the Prince of Tyre is the same being. In other words, Lucifer goes by many names. Allow me to demonstrate that in the scriptures, spiritual beings or angels are sometimes referred to as the rulers of nations. Example, the Prince of Tyre. I'll be reading from the Brenton's Septuagint. In Daniel chapter 10, I will read verses 4 to 6, verses 10 to 14, and verse 20. Daniel chapter 10, verses 4 to 6 reads thus. On the 24th day of the first month, I was near the great river, which is Tigris, Edekel, verse 5, and I lifted up mine eyes and looked, and behold, a man clothed in linen. So notice Daniel is saying he saw a man. This is very important. And his loins were girt with gold of Ophir, verse 6, and his body was as Tharsis, and his face was as the appearance of lightning, and his eyes as lamps of fire, and his arms and his legs as the appearance of shining brass, and the voice of his words as the voice of a multitude. Even though Daniel said he saw a man, it's obvious that this was not a normal man. Normal men do not have their face as the appearance of lightning, their eyes as lamps of fire, their arms and legs like shining brass, and their voices as the voice of a multitude, which is a great crowd of people. So we know that this is a powerful being that's in the form of a man. Verse 10. And behold, a hand touched me, and it raised me on my knees. 11. And he said to me, O Daniel, man greatly beloved, understand the words which I speak to thee, and stand upright. For I am now sent to thee. The Most High sent this being, this angel, to Daniel. And when he had spoken to me this word, I stood trembling. Verse 12. And he said to me, Fear not, Daniel, for from the first day that thou didst set thine heart to understand and to afflict thyself before the Lord thy God, thy words were heard. So from the very first day that Daniel prayed to the Most High for understanding, the Most High heard his words. And it continues, and I am come because of thy words. So this angel has come to Daniel to answer his prayer. Verse 13, but the prince of the kingdom of the Persians withstood me 21 days. Another spiritual being or angel fought with this angel that came with the answer to Daniel's prayer. He fought with him for 21 days. Notice that that angel is called the prince of the kingdom of the Persians. And behold, Michael, one of the princes, came to help me. Michael is another angel that came to help this angel that was fighting with the prince of the kingdom of the Persians. Angels are called princes of different nations. It continues, and I left him there with the chief of the kingdom of the Persians. So now he's being called a chief of the kingdom of the Persians. Verse 14, and I have come to inform thee of all that shall befall thy people in the last days, for the vision is yet for many days. So it should be clear that these are angels that are being referred to as princes and chiefs of nations. Verse 20, and he said, knowest thou wherefore I am come to thee? And now I will return to fight with the prince of the Persians. And as I was going in, the prince of the Greeks came. Another angel came, and this one is called the prince of the Greeks. Verse 21, but I will tell thee that which is ordained in the scripture of truth. And there is no one that holds with me in these matters but Michael, your prince, because Michael is the prince of the nation of Israel. This is the angel that is called by the name of the children of Israel. Just like another angel was called by the name of the Persians, another was called by the name of the Greeks. So when we look at the prince of Tyre, we're looking at an angel, a spiritual being. Both Isaiah and Ezekiel prophesied about the destruction of Lucifer and his children. To understand their prophecies, we must first establish the timing for these prophecies. In other words, have these prophecies already been fulfilled, or are they future prophecies? Isaiah chapter 14, verses 1 to 5 in the Brenton Septuagint. Isaiah chapter 14, verses 1 to 5 reads thus. And the Lord will, that's future tense, have mercy on Jacob. And will, future tense, yet choose Israel. And they shall, future tense, rest on their land. And the stranger shall, future tense, be added to them. Yea, shall, future tense, be added to the house of Jacob. Verse 2. And the Gentiles shall, future tense, take them and bring them into their place, and they shall, future tense, inherit them, and they shall, future tense, be multiplied upon the land for servants and handmaidens, and they that took them captives shall, future tense, become captives to them, and they that had lordship over them shall, future tense, be under their rule. So we see that these are future prophecies. The Most High will have mercy on the Israelites. He's going to return the Israelites to our land. And the nations that enslaved us, that took us captives, will be our slaves. This has not happened yet. The people that had lordship over the Israelites are not yet being ruled by the Israelites. So we know that this is a future prophecy that is yet to be fulfilled. Verse 3, and it shall, future tense, come to pass in that day, in the day when the Israelites are ruling over their captors, in that day, that the Lord shall, future tense, give thee rest from thy sorrow and vexation, and from thy hard servitude wherein thou didst serve them. Verse 4. And thou shalt, future tense. So in that day, when the Israelites are ruling this world, thou shalt take up this lamentation against the king of Babylon. How hast the extortioner ceased, and the taskmaster ceased. So this lamentation will be taken up against the spiritual being that's called the king of Babylon and the prince of Tyre, and we'll say to him, how has the extortioner ceased and the taskmaster ceased? Another word for taskmaster is slave master. It's a spiritual being that is behind the people who continue to destroy Israel to this very day. verse 5. The Lord has broken the yoke of sinners, the yoke of princes. Verse 6. Having smitten a nation in wrath. This particular nation that's being referred to are the children of the king of Babylon. Having smitten a nation in wrath with an incurable plague, smiting a nation with a wrathful plague, which spared them not, he rested in quiet. So the Most High is going to destroy that particular nation. Everybody who enslaved the Israelites will be punished. But there's a particular nation that will be smitten with an incurable plague. Incurable because it will be permanent, complete destruction. And he will spare them not. And only after that is done will he rest in quiet. Ezekiel chapter 28, verses 11 to 16. Ezekiel chapter 28, verses 11 to 16 says this. And the word of the Lord came to me, saying, verse 12, Son of man, take up a lamentation for the prince of Tyre. Notice we just read about the lamentation against the king of Babylon. Now we're reading the lamentation for the prince of Tyre. And say to him, Thus says the Lord God, Thou art a seal of resemblance and crown of beauty. 13. Thou wast in the delight of the paradise of God. The paradise of God is the Garden of Eden. This spirit, this angel, this powerful being was in the Garden of Eden. Thou hast bound upon thee every precious stone, the sardius and topaz, and emerald and carbuncle, and sapphire, and jasper, and silver, and gold, and ligure, and agate, and amethyst, and chrysolite, and beryl, and onyx. And thou hast filled thy treasures, and thy stores in thee with gold. Verse 14. From the day that thou wast created, thou wast with the cherub. So when the Most High created this powerful being, he placed him with the cherub, which is a type of angel. And I set thee on the holy mount of God. The Most High not only created this powerful, beautiful creature, but he put him on the holy mount of God. That's in a very special and privileged position. Thou wast in the midst of the stones of fire. This creature could not be burned. The stones of fire was not a threat to this creature because of how powerful he was. Verse 15, Thou wast faultless in thy days, from the day that thou wast created, until iniquity was found in thee. So the Most High created this king of Babylon, this prince of Tyre, this powerful spiritual being, and he was perfect. But later, iniquity or sin was found in this creature. Verse 16, Of the abundance of thy merchandise, thou hast filled thy storehouses with iniquity, and hast sinned. Therefore, thou hast been cast down wounded from the mount of God. Remember, the Most High set him on his holy mountain, but because of this sin, now he's being cast down from the mount of God. And the cherub has brought thee out of the midst of the stones of fire. So he's no longer allowed to be in the midst of the stones of fire, on the mount of God with the cherub. Isaiah chapter 14, verses 12 to 14. Isaiah chapter 14, verses 12 to 14 read thus. How has Lucifer... So this is the first time we're hearing this being referred to as Lucifer. But this confirmed it's all the same. King of Babylon, Prince of Tyre, Lucifer. Different names, same being. How has Lucifer that rose in the morning... fallen from heaven. He that sent orders to all the nations is crushed to the earth. Verse 13. But thou saidst in thine heart, I will go up to heaven. I will set my throne above the stars of heaven. I will sit on a lofty mount on the lofty mountains towards the north. Verse 14, I will go up above the clouds. I will be like the Most High. We read a minute ago in Ezekiel 28 that the Most High set him on the holy mount, but because of his sin, he was cast out. He was cast wounded from that mountain. But here he's saying in Isaiah 14, he's going to go right back up where he came from, back into heaven. He's going to go above the stars of heaven, and he will sit on the lofty mount. He wants to get back to where he was before, and in fact, he wants more. He wants to be like the Most High. Many modern Bibles translate the word Lucifer as morning star. For example, the New International Version says, "How you have fallen from heaven, morning star, son of the dawn." The Berean Study Bible says, "How you have fallen from heaven, O morning star, son of the dawn." The World English Bible says, "How you have fallen from heaven, morning star, son of the dawn." The reason why it's translated morning star is because Lucifer means morning star. Let's look at the Oxford Learner's Dictionary to get the definition of the word Lucifer. On the word origin, it says Old English. So Lucifer is an Old English word from Latin. It comes from the Latin language. It means light-bringing, morning star. It continues, this sense is by association with the son of the morning mentioned in the Bible, Isaiah chapter 14, verse 12, believed by Christian interpreters to be a reference to Satan. So Christian interpreters believe that Lucifer, the morning star, is Satan. However, while Christian interpreters believe that Satan is Lucifer, the morning star, the Most High never identified Satan with Lucifer. In other words, there is nowhere in the Holy Scriptures, also known as the Old Testament, where Satan is claimed to be Lucifer. In fact, Satan and Lucifer are two completely different beings. The Encyclopedia Britannica, under the heading Devil, says this. In the Old Testament, Satan is viewed as the prosecutor of Yahweh's court, as in Job chapters 1 and 2, but he is not regarded as an adversary of God. In other words, Satan works for God in his court, and he is not considered to be an enemy of God. There's nowhere in the Old Testament, the Hebrew Scriptures, that says that Satan is an enemy of God, but we've just read very clearly that Lucifer is the enemy of God, and he wants to be like the Most High God. Satan works as a tempter for the Most High. His job is to test people's faith in the Most High Yah. Sometimes he fails, as in the case of Job. See Job chapter 1 and 2. Sometimes he succeeds, as in the case of King David. See 1 Chronicles chapter 21 and 2 Kings chapter 24 in the Septuagint. 2 Kings 24 in the Septuagint is 2 Samuel chapter 24 in the KJV. And sometimes he is rebuked by the Most High, as in the case of Joshua the high priest. See Zechariah chapter 3. So yes, sometimes the Most High tells him off, just like an employer would sometimes tell off his employee, but that doesn't mean that that person is no longer the employee. Satan is in the employ of the Most High. The Most High is his employer. Let us consider the example where Satan succeeded at tempting King David. We will find that he was only doing the job that the Most High commanded him to do. 2 Kings chapter 24 in the Septuagint is 2 Samuel chapter 24 in the KJV. I will be reading 2 Kings chapter 24, verse 1 and verse 10. Verse 1 says this, "And the Lord caused his anger to burn forth again in Israel, and Satan stirred up David against them, saying, Go, number Israel and Judah." So notice, the Lord, which is the Most High God, was angry with Israel. So what did he do? He sent his employee, Satan, to stir up David against Israel, saying, "Go, number Israel and Judah." You'll never find anywhere in the scriptures where the Most High sent Lucifer to do anything. Why? Because Lucifer is his enemy. Verse 10, "And the heart of David smote him after he had numbered the people. And David said to the Lord, I have sinned grievously, O Lord, in what I have now done. Remove, I pray thee, the iniquity," which is the sin, "of thy servant, for I have been exceedingly foolish." So Satan tempted David, just like the Most High told Satan to, and Satan succeeded. Satan was just doing his job. Yet, our Christian slave masters have taught us to curse Satan. Let us turn to Ecclesiasticus chapter 21, verse 27. Ecclesiasticus is also known as Sirach, and it is in the Apocrypha. Chapter 21, verse 27. It says, "When the ungodly curses Satan, he curseth his own soul." When the ungodly curses Satan, he curses his own soul. It's the ungodly that believe that Satan is the enemy of the Most High God, so they curse him like their Christian slave masters taught them to do. But in doing so, they're cursing their own soul. Because not only is Satan in the employ of the Most High, but he's under the protection of the Most High. Satan is not Lucifer. The criteria to identify Lucifer. Number one, he claims to be God. We can find this in Ezekiel chapter 28, verse 2 and verse 6. He claims to be God. In Ezekiel chapter 28, verse 2, we find the words, "Thou hast said, I am God." That's a claim to be God. We also find the words, "Yet thou art man and not God." Remember, we looked at all these spiritual beings, angels, that were called by the names of the princes of nations, the prince of the Greeks, the prince of Persia, for example. This is similar to the prince of Tyre that we're reading about now. In Daniel chapter 10, Daniel said that he saw a man. So these angels have taken the appearance of man, but they do not cease to be angels. So when it says, "Yet thou art man and not God," this doesn't mean it's not an angel. It just means this is not God. You are not the Most High God, though thou hast set thine heart as the heart of God. In verse 6 it says, "Thou hast set thine heart as the heart of God." So Lucifer is not God. He's an angel in the form of man, yet he claims to be God. Criteria number 2, he was a glorious creature in the beginning. We'll find that in Ezekiel chapter 28, verses 12 to 13. He was a glorious creature in the beginning. In Ezekiel 28, verse 12, we find the words, "Thou art a seal of resemblance and crown of beauty." Verse 13, we find, "Thou hast bound upon thee every precious stone, the sardius and topaz and emerald and carbuncle and sapphire and jasper and silver and gold and ligure and agate and amethyst and chrysolite and beryl and onyx." This is beauty. This is glory. This is a glorious creature. And remember in verse 13, it says, "Thou wast in the delight of the paradise of God." So in the very beginning, he was in the Garden of Eden, and he was a glorious creature. Criteria number 3, he is extremely proud. Ezekiel chapter 28, verse 2, verse 5, and verse 17. He is extremely proud. In Ezekiel chapter 28, verse 2, we find the words, "Thine heart has been exalted." That's pride. In verse 5, we find the words, "Thy heart has been lifted up by thy power." That is pride. And in verse 17, we find the words, "Thy heart has been lifted up because of thy beauty." So we know that Lucifer is extremely proud. Criteria number 4. He came down from heaven. Ezekiel chapter 28, verses 16 and 17, and also Isaiah chapter 14, verse 12. In Ezekiel chapter 28, verse 16, we find the words, "Thou hast been cast down wounded from the mount of God." And in verse 17, "I have cast thee to the ground." In Isaiah 14, verse 12, it says this, "How has Lucifer, that rose in the morning, fallen from heaven?" And it also says that he is crushed to the earth. So we know that he came down from heaven. Criteria number 5, he pledged to go above the clouds and set his throne in heaven. That's in Isaiah chapter 14, verses 13 to 14. In verse 13 it says, "Thou saidst in thine heart, I will go up to heaven. I will set my throne above the stars of heaven." Verse 14, we find the words, "I will go up above the clouds." So he not only pledged to go above the clouds, but also to set his throne in heaven. These are the 5 criteria that we will use to identify the real Lucifer. Once we found the real Lucifer, we will know who the real enemy is. Lucifer, also known as the Morning Star, instructed his children to write the book called the New Testament, to lead the children of Israel into idolatry. They created a false god called Jesus Christ and forced the Israelites to worship and follow this idol. However, Lucifer's children also left many clues in the abominable New Testament so that their descendants could recognize their forefather Lucifer within its pages. Now, I am going to demonstrate that the fictitious Jesus Christ character is a clever disguise for Lucifer, the Morning Star himself. Revelation chapter 22, verse 16. Revelation chapter 22, verse 16 says this, "I, Jesus, have sent mine angel to testify unto you these things in the churches. I am the root and the offspring of David, and the bright and morning star." Jesus says, "I am the morning star." In other words, I am Lucifer. Christians and Christianlites believe everything that Jesus Christ says, except when he says that he is Lucifer. So let us see whether Jesus Christ meets the Lucifer criteria. Number 1, he claims to be God. Revelation chapter 1, verse 8. Revelation chapter 1, verse 8. Let's hear what Jesus Christ said. "I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the ending, saith the Lord, which is and which was and which is to come, the Almighty." So here Jesus Christ is claiming to be the Almighty God. There's only one Almighty, and that's the Most High God. And Jesus is claiming to be the Almighty, which means he's claiming to be God. Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 and 6. Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 and 6 says this, "Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, verse 6, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God. So he's claiming to be equal with God. That makes him God. He's saying he's in the form of God, and it's not robbery. Only Lucifer would claim to be God and think that's not robbery. How is it not robbery to take someone's identity and claim to be that person? Jesus Christ is Lucifer. Criteria number 2. He was a glorious creature in the beginning. John chapter 17, we'll read verse 5 and verse 24. John chapter 17, verse 5 and verse 24. So this is what Jesus Christ says, according to the Christian fable. And now, O Father, glorify thou me with thine own self, with the glory which I had with thee before the world was. It is true that Lucifer had a glory with the Most High God before the world was. Before everything was established, Lucifer was created and placed on the holy mountain of God. And now here he's asking, he's begging, please, Father, please, please give me the glory I had with you before the world was. But the Most High's already kicked him out. He's not going to go back. It's not happening. Verse 24. Father. See, he's begging again. Father, please, Father. I will that they also whom thou hast given me be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory. The Most High did say he was a crown of resemblance. He was extremely beautiful when he was created. So he's begging, please, restore my glory that I had with you in the beginning. So all my Christian disciples could see how beautiful and glorious I was, that they may behold my glory which thou hast given me. For thou lovest me before the foundation of the world. And it's true, it's obvious that the Most High loved Lucifer because he created him a perfect being. But it's because of Lucifer's pride and iniquity that he lost it all. So he's gotten his children to write this book called the New Testament, in which he's begging the Most High God, please, Father, restore my glory. Please, Father, love me like you did before the world began. Criteria number 3, he is extremely proud. Luke chapter 11, verses 37 to 47. Luke chapter 11, verses 37 to 47. And as he spake, a certain Pharisee besought him to dine with him. And he went in and sat down to meat. So as this Jesus Christ character was speaking, this Pharisee invited him to dinner. So he went and he sat down to eat dinner with this Pharisee. Verse 38, and when the Pharisee saw it, he marveled that he had not first washed before dinner. He was shocked, like, why are you not washing your hands? Verse 39, and the Lord, that's Jesus Christ, said unto him, now do ye Pharisees make clean the outside of the cup and the platter, but your inward part is full of ravening and wickedness. So instead of washing his dirty, stinking, nasty hands, he decided to attack his host. When someone invites you to dinner and they simply ask you kindly to wash your hands, you do not turn and start cussing them out and telling them how wicked they are. Only Lucifer is proud enough to behave like this. Christians miss this completely, but Lucifer's children understand what they're looking at. They're looking at their father, Lucifer. Verse 40, ye fools! The man only asks you to wash your hand. How does he become a fool? Did not he that made that which is without make that which is within also? What does it have to do with washing your hands? Verse 41. But rather give alms of such things as ye have, and behold, all things are clean. No, your nasty, stinking, dirty hands are not cleaned because you give alms. Just wash your hands, Lucifer. Verse 42. But woe unto you, Pharisees. He's calling destruction on the Pharisees. Why? Because he doesn't want to wash his dirty hands. For ye tithe mint and rue and all manner of herbs and pass over judgment and the love of God. These ought ye to have done and not to leave the other undone. You shouldn't be leaving your dirty hands undone. Go and wash your stinking hands, Lucifer. Do you see this? This is pride. You don't go to someone's house for dinner and then cuss them out because they ask you to wash your hands. Verse 43. Woe unto you, Pharisees! More destruction! For you love the uppermost seats in the synagogues and greetings in the market. What does this have to do with washing your dirty hands, Lucifer? Verse 44. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites! For ye are as graves which appear not, and the men that walk over them are not aware of them. Just wash your hands. I'm telling you, you don't need anything more than this to see that Lucifer is extremely prideful. Verse 45. Then answered one of the lawyers, so there were lawyers present at this dinner, looking at Lucifer making a scene, and said unto him, Master, thus saying, thou reproachest us also. In other words, when you're cursing out your host, the Pharisee, you're also cursing us, the lawyers. Now, let's hear what Lucifer replies, verse 46. And he said, Woe unto you also, ye lawyers! So, in other words, fire burn your lawyers, destruction to lawyers. Why? Because he doesn't want to wash his dirty hands. For ye laid men with burdens grievous to be borne, and ye yourself touch not the burden with one of your fingers. Verse 47. Woe unto you, for ye build the sepulchres of the prophets, and your fathers killed them. Wow. If that's what Christians want to follow, I wish them luck. As I said, the children of Lucifer know that they're reading about their father when they read the New Testament. But the Israelites are the ones who have been deceived into thinking that they're following someone that the Most High sent. The Most High did not send this devil. Criteria number 4, he came down from heaven. John chapter 6 verse 38. John chapter 6 verse 38 says this. For I came down from heaven, not to do mine own will, but the will of him that sent me. So here Lucifer is telling us, look, I came down from heaven. The only thing is, the Most High never told us that he would send anyone from heaven. However, he told us that he kicked Lucifer out of heaven because of his pride and iniquity. You do the maths. Criteria number 5. He pledged to go above the clouds and set his throne in heaven. Acts chapter 1 verse 9. Acts chapter 1 verse 9 says this. And when he had spoken these things, while they beheld, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. So here, Lucifer's disciples saw him going up on a cloud just like he promised. Ephesians chapter 4 verse 10 says, He that descended is the same also that ascended up far above all heavens, that he might fill all things. So we have a confession in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 10, telling us that the same Lucifer that descended, that came down from heaven, is the same Lucifer that ascended up far above all heavens, that he might fulfill all the things that he pledged to fulfill. He said he would go up above the cloud, he would set his throne in the heavens, he would be like the Most High. So Ephesians is telling us that Lucifer has done what he said he would do. Revelation chapter 3 verse 21. Revelation chapter 3 verse 21, so this is Lucifer speaking. It says, To him that overcometh will I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame, and am set down with my Father in his throne. So Lucifer wants to give us the impression that he overcame all these things that the Most High put to prevent him from coming back into the heavens. And now he's sitting down on the Most High throne. He says, I am set down with my Father in his throne. His throne is singular. He's sitting on the throne of the Most High, according to the garbage book called the New Testament. We can see clearly that the fictitious Jesus Christ character satisfies all the Lucifer criteria. That is because Jesus Christ is nothing but a clever disguise for Lucifer himself. In fact, no one else in the entire Bible satisfies the Lucifer criteria. Next point, Lucifer uses Satan as a scapegoat to hide his true identity. Luke chapter 10 verse 18. Luke chapter 10. Verse 18 says this, And he said unto them, I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven. So Lucifer taught his disciples that he saw Satan as lightning fall from heaven. But that couldn't be true because Satan works for the Most High God and is protected by the Most High God. And if the Most High God had cast Satan from heaven, he would have told us. But instead, what the Most High said is that he cast Lucifer from heaven. So Lucifer is using Satan as a scapegoat to hide his own true identity. Revelation chapter 12, verses 7 to 9. Revelation chapter 12, verses 7 to 9 says this. And there was war in heaven. Michael and his angel fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought and his angels, verse 8, and prevailed not, neither was their place found anymore in heaven. So Lucifer is claiming that some dragon and his angels were cast out of heaven. Verse 9. And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan. So here he's using Satan again as a scapegoat. He says, Satan which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. Now why is it the Most High never mentioned this? The only person that was cast out of heaven was Lucifer. And there was no fight, no war in heaven. The Most High said to the cherub, get rid of that idiot. I've had enough of him. And he was kicked out. It was as simple as that. We read in Ezekiel 28 that the cherub took him out from the stones of fire and the Most High cast him from the mountain of God. That was it. There was no fight in heaven, and Satan is still exactly where the Most High placed him, doing exactly what the Most High asked him to do. Lucifer is a bold-faced liar. Now that we know that Jesus Christ is simply a disguise for Lucifer, we know that the real enemy is Jesus Christ, aka Lucifer. He is the one that deceived the whole world. He is the one that was cast out of heaven because of his pride. So just to be clear, this Jesus Christ character is fictitious. It's made up. It was written by the children of Lucifer in the abominable New Testament in order to deceive the children of Israel into worshiping and following Lucifer. But it was also written in such a way that the children of Lucifer, for generations to come, could read the New Testament and identify their father within its pages. We'll go back to Isaiah chapter 14 and Ezekiel chapter 28 to learn about the destruction of Lucifer and his children. Isaiah chapter 14, verses 15 to 22. Isaiah chapter 14, verses 15 to 22 says thus, but now thou shalt go down to hell, even to the foundations of the earth. So Lucifer, aka Jesus Christ, will be going to hell. Verse 16, they that see thee shall wonder at thee and say, this is the man that troubled the earth and made kings to shake. So remember, the man simply means that this being, this powerful creature, is in the form of a man. Just like in Daniel chapter 10, we learn that the angel that appeared to Daniel was in the form of a man. So this Lucifer is the man that troubled the earth, that made kings to shake, while claiming it was Satan that was causing havoc. Verse 17. That made the whole earth desolate and destroyed its cities. He loosed not those who were in captivity. To this day, Lucifer refuses to release those Israelites that are in captivity. Their minds are enslaved because they continue to worship him. They continue to follow him and to see him as a great teacher because of his disguise as Jesus Christ. Verse 18, all the kings of the nations lie in honor, every man in his house. Verse 19, but thou, meaning thou Lucifer, shalt be cast forth on the mountains as a low carcass, with many dead who have been pierced with swords, going down to the grave. Lucifer Christ will be put to death. He will go down to the grave, down to hell. Verse 20, as a garment defiled with blood shall not be pure, so neither shalt thou be pure, because thou hast destroyed my land. So Lucifer is the one behind the destruction of Israel. the land that the Most High God has promised to his people, and has slain my people. Lucifer is the one that sent his children to enslave the Israelites from the west coast of Africa on the good ship Jesus. Lucifer Christ is the one who inspires his people to oppress the Israelites to this very day. Lucifer Christ is the one who has charged his people to deny the Israelites our heritage. Lucifer is the one who instructed his children to deceive the children of Israel so that we'll worship him instead of worshiping the Most High God. Many Israelites, Christianlites, give lip service to the Most High God while following the teachings of Lucifer Christ in the New Testament. It continues, "Thou shalt not endure forever." So whereas Lucifer says that he is the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end, the Almighty, which means that he will live forever and have great power, the Most High says to him, "Thou shalt not endure forever. Thou an evil seed." Not only is Lucifer an evil seed, but every one of his children is an evil seed. As Lucifer himself said, an evil tree cannot produce good fruit. He is an evil seed, and his children are like him. Verse 21, "Prepare thy children," meaning your evil seed, "to be slain, put to death for the sins of their father." Those children of Lucifer who enslaved the Israelites, who took us from West Africa on the good ship Jesus, and there was nothing good about it, they will be slain for the sins of their father. Those children of Lucifer who continue to oppress the Israelites to this very day, they will be slain for the sins of their father. It continues, "That they arise not and inherit the earth, nor fill the earth with wealth." Why? Because that's exactly what they do. The children of Lucifer are the ones who inherited the earth, which is not theirs. They are virus on this planet, and they fill the earth with wars. This earth would be a much better place had it not been for the children of Lucifer. Verse 22 says, "And I will rise up against them." So the Most High is going to rise up against the children of Lucifer, says the Lord of hosts, "and I will destroy their name and remnant and seed." Every child of Lucifer will be destroyed. Every evil seed will be destroyed. Thus saith the Lord. Let's go to Ezekiel 28, verses 18 to 19. Ezekiel chapter 28, verses 18 to 19, in the Brenton Septuagint, reads thus, "Because of the multitude of thy sins and the iniquities of thy merchandise, I have profaned thy sacred things." So this Christian church and the cross and all these things that they claim to be sacred, the Most High said those things are profane. Why? Because of the sin of idolatry. Lucifer, aka Jesus Christ, has committed a multitude of sins against the Most High and against his people. And the Most High said, "Your sacred things are abominable. They are profaned in my sight. And I will bring fire out of the midst of thee. This shall devour thee." Remember that Lucifer once dwelt in the midst of the stones of fire with the cherub. Fire did not hurt him. But now the Most High is saying, "I'm going to bring fire out of the midst of you." The same fire that did not destroy you will now devour you. "And I will make thee to be ashes upon the land before all that see thee." So this Lucifer or Jesus Christ will be made ashes. Some God. This is what Christians choose to worship. This is what Christian lights choose to follow as their idol. The Most High will destroy Lucifer, aka Jesus Christ. Verse 19. "And all that know thee among the nations shall groan over thee." You see, Lucifer is well known among the nations. Yes, by another name, Jesus Christ, but he's well known. And when the Most High destroys him with fire and his ashes, the people that know him among the nations, they'll be groaning and moaning, "Not my Jesus!" But it will be too late. They've been deceived. "Thou art gone to destruction, and thou shalt not exist any more." So just like we've learned that the children of Lucifer will not exist anymore, Lucifer himself will not exist anymore. So the nations will be groaning or mourning over Lucifer because they think that they are worshiping and following Jesus Christ. And they will be in shock and disbelief when they find out that they have been worshiping and following Lucifer all this time. In the New World Encyclopedia, under the heading Jesus of Nazareth, this is what it says. Jesus Christ is Christianity's central figure, both as Messiah and, for most Christians, as God incarnate. Muslims regard him as a major prophet, and some regard him as the Messiah. Many Hindus also recognize him as a manifestation of the divine, as do Baha'i believers, while some Buddhists identify him as a bodhisattva. So what we're learning here is that Christians worship Jesus Christ. Christianlites, which are those other Christians, see him as their Messiah. Muslims see him as a major prophet and some as the Messiah. Hindus see him as a manifestation of God. Baha'i believers see him as a manifestation of God. Buddhists identify him as a bodhisattva, which is some great spiritual leader and teacher. So all these different religions, what they have in common is that they follow Jesus Christ to some extent. And this is why these nations are going to mourn. Because whether they were Christians or Muslim or Hindu or Baha'i or Buddhist, they're following this Jesus Christ character, which is actually a disguise for Lucifer. And they're going to be in shock. Earlier, I proved that Isaiah 14 is a future prophecy that has not yet been fulfilled. Now I will do the same for Ezekiel chapter 28. And naturally, as it is a parallel passage for Isaiah 14, it also is a future prophecy that has not yet been fulfilled. Ezekiel chapter 28, verses 25 to 26. Ezekiel chapter 28, verses 25 to 26 in the Brenton Septuagint says this: "Thus saith the Lord God, I will," future tense, "also gather Israel from the nations." Israel has not yet been regathered, so we know this has not happened yet, among whom they have been scattered. We are still scattered among these nations. "And I will," future tense, "be sanctified among them." The Most High is not sanctified amongst all Israelites, because there are many Israelites who still don't know they are Israelites, and there are many Israelites who choose to sanctify Lucifer as Jesus Christ instead of the Most High God. They simply give lip service to the Most High God while following Lucifer, aka Jesus Christ. So we know this has not happened yet, and before the peoples and nations, he will be sanctified before all nations. "And they shall," future tense, "dwell upon their land." If you are an Israelite listening to the sound of my voice and you're not dwelling in the land of Israel in peace and ruling the world, you know this has not happened yet, "which I gave to my servant Jacob." Verse 26. "Yea, they shall," future tense, "dwell upon it safely." The few Israelites that are in the land of Israel are not dwelling safely today. So this has not happened yet. "And they shall," future tense, "build houses and plant vineyards and dwell securely. When I shall," future tense, "execute judgment on all that have dishonored them." Lucifer and his children have not yet been punished for destroying the Most High's people. The other nations that enslaved and oppressed the Israelites have not yet received the judgment that is due to them. So we know that this has not happened yet, even on those that are round about them. "And they shall," future tense, "know that I am the Lord their God." I am is singular. None of this Trinity nonsense about three in one. Three is not one. I am. The Most High God alone is. He said, I am their God, not Jesus Christ, and the God, singular, of their fathers. We have learned that Satan is not the same being as Lucifer. We have also discovered that the fictitious character Jesus Christ is simply Lucifer in disguise. When the Most High comes to regather the Israelites, both Lucifer and his children will be destroyed once and for all. If Christians and Christianlites want to continue to worship and follow Lucifer, the choice is theirs. You have been warned. My conscience is clear. And with that, I say, Shalom. And remember, if you find these teachings beneficial and would like to learn more, please like, share, and subscribe.